And more importantly, and simply turn coffee here after service to receive your free gift. We are excited to announce that our last service of the year will be held on Sunday the 29th at 5 p.m. here in the auditorium.
Feel free to bring any Christmas outfit and or ugly sweater, like this here Georgia shirt, and bring your appetite for some hot chocolate and dessert.
Ooh.
We would like you to join one of our C groups in the new year.
We have several incredible C groups that are currently meeting, and a brand new one will launch in the home of Jared and Hope Stills in the new year.
You can find a complete list of our C groups in our website and on our app.
We were never intended to do life solo, so be sure to join a Connect group in the new year.
Our kids ministry is hosting a Celebrate at 8 New Year's Eve party on December 31st from 6 to 8 p.m.
The party will be held at the depot at Mount Park Park. There'll be games, snacks, prizes, music, and...
And be sure to bring some type of clock. This is for ages 1st through 5th grade.
Flame of Flame! So make plans to celebrate to the stroke of 8 p.m. For more info, you can see Miss Ray Tyler Cajula.
Don't miss our meal immediately following our candlelight service today here in the cafeteria.
It is a catered meal, so you don't have to worry about bringing anything but yourself. And you don't want to miss the special entertainment provided by our staff.
So make plans to eat with us here in a few moments.
Well, that's it for our announcements today.
Once again, thanks so much for being here, and feel free to let us know who did better.
Now let's get started with the service.
Good morning. Man, those guys are hilarious. Hey, we're so glad that you're here to celebrate Christmas with us here this morning. Here, we'll get out of the way for them so they can set up. A couple quick announcements. Yeah, after church, we have a catered lunch. So please join us in the cafeteria after church for that. And there is a special treat for you guys that's going to be put on by the staff. It'll be pretty funny. So we hope you can stay for that. Also, Miles, if you'll hold the verse for us. This right here is something called the Bible study. The youth is going to be going through a 90-day study of the Bible starting in January and how it relates to them. We're going to read through the whole New Testament and then hit the main parts, each book of the Old Testament together. We're going to start January 5th. So if you don't have any Christmas gifts yet or need last-minute ideas for your child or grandchild or somebody else's child, pick up one of these online at thebrandsunday.com. I believe they're like $15. Most of the work is done at home, but on Sunday we'll debrief everything that we read the week. And so it's a pretty awesome opportunity for them to get in the Word. The college group is also doing a year-long Bible study starting January 5th. But that's something separate. You can also order that book at the same website. I've got Miles and Landon who are going to help me read the scripture for us today. To kick off our Christmas Eve service, we're going to be in the book of John. And this is what it says, John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.
He was in the Word, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor human decision, or husband's will, but born of God.
The Word became flesh and made it his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Let's pray. God, thank you for this time that we get to come and center ourselves before we step into, we're already in the middle of the Christmas season, but before we step into really what it means this time and the joy and peace that was brought in the world on this special day, thank you for sending your Son so we can get back to you for eternity, but also here and now to live for you now. Thank you just for everybody in this room. Continue to bless us in all your ways you do. And just be in this service so we can feel your Holy Spirit, Lord, and draw us closer to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
let me tell you a story. In the beginning was the Word, who was with God and was God. And without him, nothing would have been made. There would be only darkness. Before God breathed life into man and woman to care for all that was created, before there were the beasts of the field to roam the earth, before creatures of the sea and creatures of the air, before there were markers in the sky to guide our way, before the dry ground and fields of wheat, before the heavens separated from the earth, before all things were created, there was only darkness. But God spoke. Let there be light. And light was born, spilling into the darkness, bringing comfort where there's fear, hope where there's dismay, life where there's death. This light, this Word, became flesh and made his dwelling among us, so that every heart can have its new beginning.
Good morning. Merry Christmas. Y'all come on out, let's sing. I don't know about you. I was kind of excited. I was talking with Landon Stansberry. He was telling me he likes Christmas break better than he does summer break. I was like, what, really? He said, yeah. I was like, why? He said, I don't know, I just like it. And I was like, that's good enough for me. Because I'm the kind of the same way. I like my Christmas break. I don't get a summer break. I work through summer, but I do love when Christmas comes around. It kind of helps me to truly remember just how much God loves me, loves us, that he would send his only begotten son for us. So with that in mind, we're going to sing a good song this morning, Angels We Have Heard on High. And hopefully y'all will sing along with us, and we'll sing it joyfully. Can we do that? You want to stand to your feet? And let's sing this song.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
worship him.
Joyful and triumphant, O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morn.
I hope that in the busyness of things, and I don't know if you're like me, but I don't tell Christy, but I'm not finished with all the shopping just yet. And I don't know if that's you or not, but this time of the year is busy. There's a lot of things going on, a lot of family gatherings. There's shopping to be done, baking to be had. There is church services to go to and all these different things. And what I love about Christmas is that it does cause us to kind of pause at some point in time. Maybe it happens at 3 o'clock on Christmas Day after all the wrapping paper's all over the floor and everybody's kind of doing their thing, where you get a chance to pull back just a little bit, take a little bit of a nap. But there's something about Christmas and after Christmas that I think that lends itself to us taking a little bit of a breather. And I hope that you will have an opportunity to be able just to adore who Christ is and what he's done for you, to pull back a little bit and say, Lord, I thank you for what you've done for me, because we want you to know that the birth of Jesus really, really is an incredible, incredible thing for us. It's an incredible gift that's been given to us so that we can know God, know who he is, and we can also live this life to the fullest so that we recognize that after this life, is over with. Because I don't know about you, but I've lived now 49 years, and it has gone like really, really fast. And I was just talking to Paul. It's his birthday today. By the way, Paul and Ann's birthday today. At the end of service, we'll make sure that we do something special for them. But Paul turned 24, and I went, wow, I don't even know if I remember 24. Do you remember when you were 24? Some of you aren't even there yet, but nonetheless, it's incredible. So hopefully this Christmas season, you'll have an opportunity to pull back just a little bit, kind of catch your breath, and just take in who Jesus is and what he's done for you. We're going to take the opportunity right now to take up offering. If you're new with us here at MC3, first of all, let somebody say thank you for coming. Second of all, we have two rules here when it comes to giving at MC3. The first rule is give what the Lord asks you to give, and give cheerfully. And so if you're new with us, you're not compelled. If you're a believer in Christ, well, it's hard to get around that. So nonetheless, we will pass the buckets here in a second. But let me pray for us just for our offering today. Father, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord God, to remember what you have done for us. Not only that you came as a little baby, but that you died for us at the cross. Those two are forever linked, the manger and the cross. And Father, we thank you for your gift to us. And Father, today, during this offering time, Lord, it's not our gift back to you. It's simply us doing what you've required us to do as believers in Christ, just to give to you so that ministry can continue. And so, Father, I thank you for the gifts that will be placed in the buckets, and I thank you, Lord God, for the lives that that will impact, both here locally and even abroad. And so, Father, we pray that you would bless the gift, bless the giver, Lord God, and thank you for the opportunity just to know who you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Series that we have been calling Jesus Changes Everything. The fact that the birth of Jesus changes everything about us. And here, think about this for a second. Here's Jesus in this Christmas season, a tiny little baby born in a manger. Most of us don't even really know what a manger is apart from Christmas time. Here's this little baby born in a manger, and yet when we look at Scripture, and even more, maybe even more importantly than that, if you don't believe in Scripture, even when you look at the lives of certain people that are believers in Christ, and if you could see their lives before Christ and their lives after Christ, we can see that He is so much more than that tiny little baby that is placed in a manger. That tiny little baby that we see at the nativity scene, maybe on my grandmother had a really neat one that she kept on a little chest inside of her kitchen. I remember all those little pieces, and it's forever etched in my mind. So if you can remember all of that, here's this little tiny little baby, Jesus, and He's so much more than just that tiny little baby. How does that tiny little baby change everything for us? How does that tiny little baby change, as we've talked about over the last few weeks, how does He change my lifestyle? How does that even happen? How does He change my family? The way that I minister to my family, the way that I parent, the way that I love my wife. How does Jesus change that? How does Jesus change the way that I love other people, the way that I view love for other people, whether that is love for my wife or love for my kids or just my friends, neighbors, people, even perfect strangers. How in the world does a tiny little baby change all of that? How does a tiny little baby change me? How does He change me? And so over the last few weeks, we've been kind of asking ourselves that question. And here's the deal. Jesus really is a game changer. He's a game changer. And whether we know it or not, or whether we realize it or not, or whether we are aware of it or not, He has changed history the moment He came into our world, even though He only lived to be about 33 years old and only had a 3-year ministry. And yet, His impact, His splash in this world, and even on our world today, 2,000 years later, is forever seen. His fingerprints are all over things. Even the way that we even the way that we judge time, you know, 2020 is upon us. That changed because Jesus stepped into our world. And so I get to thinking about this for a second, because if I were to put myself in the shoes of someone who's not a believer of Jesus, someone who's not a follower of Christ, if I were to put myself in their shoes, what would I think about this time of year? Have you ever thought about that for a second? Maybe for some of you, it's been a long time since you were outside of Christ, since you came to Christ. That's almost been eons ago. Maybe for some of you, you've never been that way because you've always grown up in the church. And maybe for some of you, you stepped in, you're like, okay, I'm here. Maybe somebody fooled you into coming here today. Hey, we got a lunch. Come to lunch with us. And you agreed, and all of a sudden you landed right here, and you're like, oh, no, this is a church service, you know. So if you got boondoggled into being here, or whether you chose to be here, even if you're a believer or you're not a believer, I want to put myself in the shoes just briefly. Maybe all of us can do this if you're a believer in Christ. If you put yourself in the shoes of someone who is not a believer, and I think the natural question would be, does the message of Jesus, the message of his birth and his life, does it really matter to me? Does that really matter to me? How does that impact me? Even if someone were to agree, yeah, I believe the account in Scripture. Not a follower, but I believe the account. Even if someone were to agree about that, how does that impact someone? Well, there was a doctor that did put himself in someone else's shoes, and he asked in some ways the same kind of question. Now, we aren't told if what prompted this doctor to answer that question was the fact that his friend asked him, or whether he just took it upon himself on behalf of his friend to answer this question. But we know that this doctor did set out to answer the question, does the birth and the life of Jesus really matter? Does it really matter to me? Does it matter to you? Does it matter to the people that we love, that we care for? Does it matter to our neighbors and our friends and coworkers and all of that? And so, like an investigative reporter, he begins to dig down deep into the life of Jesus. And he brings more facts and more substance maybe than most of us probably would care to know. And yet, these things that he brings up are important. And so what we find is that this doctor gives us more facts about Jesus than all the other Gospels combined when it comes to his birth, the birth of Jesus. In fact, we read his letter probably more times than not at this time of year because of his investigation, because he dug deep into the life and the birth of Jesus. And so he documents all these facts, writes them down in a concise way that we can understand who Jesus is and the fact that his birth and his life really should matter to me, and it should matter to all of us. And here's how he starts his letter. He says, many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything, that's key, since I have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know with certainty the things that you have been taught. And so of all the things that Luke starts in his report, he starts by going to, if you look in Luke chapter 1, he goes to the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, and how Zechariah is visited by an angel named Gabriel, and Gabriel says that in your old age, you are going to have a son, and you're going to name him John, and he's going to pave the way for the Messiah. He's going to make the path straight for the Messiah, for Jesus to come into the world. This is where Luke begins in his message to Theophilus about who Jesus is and why he really does matter and why his birth and his life are really important to all of us. And what Luke discovers is that the lives of, now catch this, the lives of ordinary, regular people like Zechariah and Elizabeth point to Jesus. The lives of regular, ordinary, average people like Zechariah and Elizabeth really, really do matter. Because about 6 months or so later, that same angel will visit a Jewish, regular, normal, unmarried woman by the name of Mary. And that angel's message was that out of all the people who were on the planet, and out of all the people who have ever lived, and out of all the people who will ever live into the future, she was chosen. She was chosen by God to give birth to the Son of God, Emmanuel, God with us, God in the flesh. And not only does Luke document all of this in detail, but he documents Mary and Elizabeth's conversation about it as Mary, after she hears this about the angel, goes and visits with Elizabeth, and they talk with one another. And not only that, but Luke also, somehow, whether he interviewed Mary or whether Mary wrote it down or whatever, but he actually documents what is called in Scripture Mary's song. It could have been a poem that she jotted down, or maybe something that she just, a memory that she wanted to make sure she captured. And Luke documents all of these things. He documents Mary's thoughts in his investigation about why the birth of Jesus and the life of Jesus really should matter to all of us. But some of the best detail that Luke investigates is on the very night that Jesus was born. On the very night that Jesus was born. Listen to his accuracy in Luke chapter 2. He says this, "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria." So he qualifies for Theopolis, the time frame in which all this happened. So Theopolis would go, "Oh, I know, I remember when that was, or I remember in history when that all took place. I remember that." And so he qualifies that for him. Now, for you and I, that may not mean a whole lot. That's just extra information. But for Theopolis, that meant everything as to when the timing of when all this took place. And then he says this in verse 3, "And everyone went to their own town to register." And Luke begins to tell about Mary and her betrothed, Joseph, and why they travel to Bethlehem from Galilee, because they lived in Galilee and they had to travel down to Bethlehem, so they travel south to Bethlehem. And then he tells about their accommodations when they get into Bethlehem, how there's not really a place for them to stay, and they're staying in the stables, and that Jesus has got to be placed in the manger. And then Luke uncovers, more than likely through interviewing Mary and maybe some others that were there at the time, because Joseph is gone by this time. He's already with the Lord. Luke uncovers a stunning account of these shepherds. Again, regular, normal, ordinary, everyday shepherds out in the fields doing what regular, normal, everyday, average shepherds do, just watching over their sheep by night. And he records how, and I want you to listen to this, how these angels visit them. Listen to how Luke documents this. He says this, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, and he is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths," or in swaddling clothes, as we see in the King James Version. And he will be lying in a manger." And suddenly, Luke says, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And when the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen them, they spread the word concerning what had been told about them, about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. And what Luke records in his letter to Theopolis and to us is evidence that answers the question, does the birth and the life of Jesus really, really matter to me? Does the birth and the life of Jesus really, really matter to you? Does it really matter to you? And what Luke reports is that it mattered to regular, ordinary people like Zechariah and Elizabeth and John. It mattered to regular, average, everyday people like Mary and Joseph. It mattered to unnamed shepherds that were out of the field just doing their ordinary thing when all of a sudden God showed up into our world. See, the birth and the life of Jesus should matter to me, and it should matter to you. But the big question is, why? Why? Why should it matter? If I'm thinking about my friends and my family that aren't believers, why should it matter to them? Why should it matter that Jesus came? Why should it matter that Luke records all of these things? Why should it matter? Well, it matters because of what the angel says to the shepherds. And Luke wrote it down. Here's what he writes in verse 10 through 11. We read it before. Maybe you caught it. Maybe you didn't. Here's what the angel says. He says, I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. For all the people. That's me. And that's you. You are inserted in the story. You are inserted in the biblical account of the birth and the life of Jesus. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for you. For you. For Tekelwan and for Robert, for Alan, for Caleb, for all of us. Our name is inserted in the story. But then it goes on in verse 11 to say this. The angel says, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born, not to Mary and Joseph, not to you shepherds, but the fact that a Savior has been born to you. He's been born to all of us. That's you and that's me. We are inserted in the story. I bring you good news of great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. And He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. He is God with us. He is Emmanuel. And this is what Luke was saying to Theophilus. This is what he's saying to me. And this is what he's saying to you. God was thinking about you. God was thinking about, and you can insert your name in there. God was thinking about you. He was thinking about me. Excuse me. Right about now. Excuse me. Right about now. Try again. We got it? For a little bit, maybe. Some of you shook my hand. Are rethinking that right now, aren't you? Yeah. That's right, going, ooh. So, God was thinking about you, and He was thinking about me. But it even goes further back than that. Approximately 2,000 years before Jesus stepped into the world, in Genesis 12, God visits an ordinary, average Mesopotamian man by the name of Abram, who will be known as Abraham, and He promises him. He says, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all peoples on the earth, that's you and that's me, will be blessed through you. He promises Abram a son in his old age. And God makes good on that promise. When his wife is 90 and he is 100 years old, God makes good on that. You see, God was thinking about you all the way back in Genesis, all the way back in Genesis chapter 12. God was thinking about you, and He was thinking about me. We were on His mind, and we were on His heart all the way back, 2,000 years before Jesus was even born. But it goes back even further than that. All the way back in Genesis chapter 3, at the fall of man, when Adam and Eve sin in the garden, we see God the Father already has in mind you, and he already has in mind me and what he's going to do, because he came into this world so that he might redeem us for himself. And he says to Satan, he says to him, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. You see, God was thinking about you and me because he had already had in mind he was going to send Jesus in to save us from our sins, to save me from my sins. You matter to God. You, insert your name there, matter to God. Luke's message to Theopolis, Luke's message to you, and Luke's message to me is that you matter. God cares for you, so much so that he would send Jesus into our world. And what Luke does is he answers the question, does God care about me? Absolutely. And all we have to do is look at the manger, and we have to look at the cross, and we see God does care. Jesus cares enough to enter into our world and experience the human condition. All the things we go through, from colds to sore throats, all those types of things, Jesus can experience all those human conditions that we experience. He knows us. He knows what we've been through. And yet he was perfect, and he died for us on the cross. That's how much you matter to God. That's how much I matter to God. And in John 3, as Jesus is sitting around with a religious leader at night, because the religious leader is afraid during the daytime to show his face, Jesus says these words, "For God so loved the world." For God so loved, insert your name there. For God so loved you that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God had me. God had you in mind when he sent Jesus. God had, insert your name there, in mind when he sent Jesus. So does the birth and the life of Jesus matter to me? Does the birth and the life of Jesus matter to you? I hope so. I hope so. I hope you can answer yes to that question, because I know this, Jesus had you in mind. He had me in mind when he sent Jesus, the light of the world, as a tiny little baby, on that silent night, on that holy night. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your great love for us, Father, that you would care enough for us. Lord, a part of me steps outside of myself and says, who am I that you even care, that you even know my name? And yet we see in Scripture that you know us. You know every detail about all of us in this room and around the planet. And it blows my mind away. But Father, I thank you that you care enough, not only just to know us in trivial ways, like how many hairs are on our head and those types of things, but you care enough that you would send your one and only Son into the world so that he might experience what I experience, so that he might rub elbows with us, show us how to live, and then to take up my cross, not his, because he committed no sin, but I did, to take up my cross and die for me, to take up our cross and to die for us. Father, thank you that you care enough, that you love us enough, that you would do that for us. And Father, I pray that in this Christmas season that we might be able to share the message, that we might be able to share why you really matter, why the birth why your life and why your death and why your resurrection really do matter to all of us. Thank you, Father God, for Jesus. Thank you for this Christmas season. And thank you, Lord God, for the hope that you give to us in this world and in the next. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. The census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone in his own city.
Joseph also went from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over the flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone about them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you: you will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly with the angel, a multitude of the heavenly host proclaiming God, saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill towards men."
So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told to them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told to them.
And after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'"
Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star had appeared, he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring him back word to me that I may come and worship him also." when they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way.
By the way, here we go. Here's our candles with a twist. We don't want you to get burned, okay? So basically all you do is you pick up these candles, and on the bottom there's a little on and off switch. You turn it on and you can hold it out like this. We invite you to pick one up as you partake of communion. We have communion in the back. We have communion up here. And if you're unable to maneuver around, just raise your hand and one of our servers will come and make sure that you have communion, and also we'll make sure that you have a candle. And we're going to take the opportunity to make sure that we share this time in communion and remember that Jesus really is, as Will read at the very beginning when we started this service, that Jesus really is the light of the world. Light has come into our world, and now we carry that light to those around us. So as you partake of communion, remember what Jesus has done for you, how his birth, his life, and how his death and resurrection really do matter. And now we have the opportunity as believers in Christ to carry his light to the people around us. And so we want to make sure that at this time, as we have this candlelight moment together, that we remember what Christ has done for each and every one of us. I'm going to pray one more time, and then we feel free to get up and partake of communion and to grab a candle. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the message, Lord God, of your birth. Thank you, Father, that that each gospel writer comes at a different angle to help give us a more full picture about who you are and why you've come. We thank you, Father God, that story doesn't stop at the manger. It doesn't stop where with the Magi rejoicing at seeing the star and traveling home. It's only the beginning of the journey. And so, Father, we thank you for sending Jesus to live this life and to die for us, only to be raised up 3 days later because of your power. We thank you, Father, because within communion, what we see, Lord God, in the bread is your body that was broken for us, the cross, but we see your blood represented by the cup that reminds us of your victory. Because by your blood we are healed. Because you poured your blood out the cross, we have victory. That even though we pass from this life, we know that there is eternal life waiting for us in the next. Father, I pray you'd help us, Lord God, to shine our light collectively as a church and individually as people, Lord God, that we would shine the light you've given to us via the Holy Spirit. And so, Father, I pray today that as we partake, that we're reminded of what you've done for us, but also, Lord God, we're reminded of what we need to do to make sure that that family member, that friend, that coworker would know about you. Those that don't know or don't believe or don't follow, Lord God, that we might reach them for you. Bless us as we partake. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Okay, guys, be seated. I tell you, I love that song. That song is Silent Night. Those are two of my favorite Christmas carols. I always, especially Silent Night, that very first verse I always love. But the one I always think about is the one about shepherds quaking and the angels here. And try to imagine what it must have been like to be there on Christmas night and for the angels to come down to the shepherds. That's just always been something that amazed me. But anyway, so glad everyone was here today. A couple of things to tell you about that we need to know. First off, remember, we're going to have service next week at 5 o'clock instead of 10 o'clock, so there will not be a Sunday school hour either, so just plan to be here a little before about 4:30 or so, partake in coffee and all that good stuff. We'll have dessert to follow afterwards in the lobby here at Parkview. That'll be a lot of fun. Really great news for the setup crew. We get to keep everything in place for 2 weeks. No moving or loading trailers or unloading trailers or anything like that. So for our setup crews next week, if you guys could plan to arrive about 4 o'clock, that would be awesome. And then finally, the last thing to mention, of course, you guys know we have dinner coming up or lunch coming up in the cafeteria. Barbecue, ribs, and pork, and chicken, and all the fixings, peach cobbler, so it should be a good time. We're asking for a $5 donation for the adults, if you could. If not, no worries about that, though. So, anything else we need to mention? I don't think so. All right, let's bow out and close with prayer, and then head on over to the cafeteria, okay? Dear Lord, what an amazing thing it is that you sent your son to die for us. We get so caught up in the Christmas season and all the rushing and hustle and bustle that comes with it, we can really forget the reason for the season, God. And yet, when we think about what it must have been like in Israel all those years ago, more than 2,000 years ago now, when your son was born, you sent angels to talk to shepherds and you sent wise men later on. It's just an amazing story, God, and you did it all for us so that one day we might have that chance to have life in heaven with you, God. It says, thank you so much, God. We know we're not worthy. We fail so often, but you didn't care. You didn't care about all of our faults and our failures. You had a son. You had a plan in mind to redeem us and save us, God. So we thank you so much for that, Lord. God, we thank you for everyone here today. I know their families are together. It's a special time of the year. We pray a special blessing on each and every family here. At the same time, Lord, we're mindful of those who don't have families with us now. We're mindful of those who've lost loved ones at this time of year, God. It can make it so hard for them. So we pray an extra special blessing on them as well, dear Lord. Lord, we thank you for the message we heard today. Just let it seep into our bones, God. Give us all a special time together, and with our, as I said earlier, with our families these next few days, Lord, and just let this be the best Christmas season that every person in this room has ever had in their life. So in all these things, Lord, we ask for your blessings, and your will be done. Amen.
Lord.